Well, my text for today is in the letter of Paul to the believers in Philippi. That would be in chapter 3, verse 10. You know, at this time, Paul comes to the end of his life transforming testimony, and he sets two goals for his life: to know Christ and to know the power of his resurrection. This is Paul's primary desire. This is what Paul wants more than anything else in his life. These goals are the standards Paul sets for his deeper walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. So what do they mean for us? What does Paul mean when he says he wants to know Christ and he wants to know the power of his resurrection? First of all, what does knowing Christ mean? Let us first consider whether or not this desire belongs to Paul alone. Is Paul stating a personal preference, or this is a truth that is essential for all humanity? You know, in Jeremiah chapter 9, verses 23 to 24, this is what the Lord says: "Let not the wise boast of their wisdom, or the strong boast of their strength, or the rich boast of their riches. But let the one who boast about this, that they have the understanding to know me, that I am the Lord who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. For in these I delight, declares the Lord." Knowing God is more important than wisdom, or strength, or riches. Think about the people who are most admired in this world today. They are admired for these three qualities. We tend to admire those who are bright, intelligent, knowledgeable, or those who are physically gifted in strength, talent, or beauty, or those who have a lot of money. But the Lord says through Jeremiah that none of those are of great importance. What matters more than anything else is understanding and knowing the Lord, the covenant God who delights in kindness, righteousness, and justice. And this importance of knowing God carries over into the Gospels. Jesus himself, on the night prior to his death, prays for his followers in the Garden of Gethsemane, saying, "Now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." And that is in John chapter 17, verse 3. Eternal life is what? Knowing God and knowing Jesus. Without knowing God and without knowing Jesus, there is no eternal life. And Peter emphasizes this point in his letter. He says, "His divine power have given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness." Our knowledge of him leads to his empowering us with everything we need for life and godliness. Apostle John makes a similar point near the close of his first letter in chapter 5, verse 20. He says, "We know also that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, even in his Son Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life." John says that Jesus came so that we might know him. The purpose of the incarnation or the celebration of Christmas was for our knowing, to know him. So Old Testament, New Testament, the letters of Paul, Peter, and John all agree that knowing God and knowing Jesus is supremely important. But what does knowing Jesus mean? We get to know a person in part by being in His physical presence. But how do we get to know Jesus? Surely, knowing Jesus is much more than knowing facts about Him. How can we come into this deep personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ? First, surely we must know about Him. So we do indeed need to learn about Jesus, His life, His purpose, His death, and His ministry. And how do we do this? Of course, in part, by listening to faithful preachers of God's Word. In part, by regular reading and studying of the Bible. And in part, by witnessing the impact of God on the lives of other people. Second, we must go beyond learning the facts. We must cultivate our own relationship with Him. So let us consider three steps to cultivating relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. The first step is putting your faith in Him. Believing that He is the Son of God. Believing that the event we celebrate today, the resurrection, really did take place. And wanting Him to make you a new creation. A second step is spending time in prayer. Pray alone and pray with others. In prayer, you can share all your joys, all your frustrations and sorrows with the God of the universe. The God who cares. And talking to God, talking to Jesus, builds that relationship. And the third step is following. Listen as you pray and read the Bible. Be willing to follow. Even when His commands don't seem to make sense. Depend on what God, with all His requirements that seem unreasonable. And when you do this, when you step out in faith, He will be there to sustain you and to support you. And you will see Jesus as a living, risen Savior. Now let's talk about the power of His resurrection. Because this is the second goal that Paul sets for his life. That he wants to know the power of Christ's resurrection. The power of Christ's resurrection is evident in several ways in our deeper walk with Jesus. First, in our freedom. You know, it's funny, when people come to Christ, they believe they have to give up all this stuff they have in the world. You know, the reason many people don't come is that they are afraid to give up the world. They think that serving Christ is a sort of bondage. You have to do this, you have to do that, don't do this, don't do that. The reality is that the deeper we walk with Christ, the more free we become. Free to be who we are created to be. Free to love without worry or possessiveness. Free to venture without fear because God is in it. Free to live beyond the bondage of sin. And free to experience life without the burdens of sin and bondage. Jesus Christ died and rose again so that we could be free. Paul says in his letter to the people in Galatia, it was for freedom that Christ set us free. Therefore keep standing firm and do not be subject again to a yoke of slavery. The second evidence of the power of resurrection of Jesus in our lives is our expectancy. Look at the disciples. While they walk with Jesus, they live lives filled with wonder. Every time Jesus worked a miracle, they were amazed. Whether it was the feeding of the 5,000, the calming of the storm, the walking on the water, the healing, the casting out of demons constantly, they were amazed at what He did and what He said. You know, man always underestimates the power of God. But After the resurrection, however, nothing God that surprises them anymore. Life is about the miraculous power of Christ to transform lives and the world around them. Paul tells us in his letter to the Ephesians that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly more than we can ask or even think, according to the power that works within us. That is resurrection power. And lastly, Paul is able to face without fear. Security. We're talking about security. In his letter to the believers in Philippi, he said, "For me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Paul is able to live his life with abandon for Christ because he knows that the world cannot take anything away from him that is important to him. And all those things that are truly important and precious are eternal in nature, and they can never be taken away. The power of Jesus' resurrection is the assurance of eternity, the removal of the sting of death, and the weakening of the enemy. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." Do you believe this?
Yes.
Do you believe this? That's what Jesus asked. Do you know Jesus and the power of his resurrection? If you don't know Jesus and the power of resurrection, I would like for you to come to Jesus today and be saved. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for the great richness of truth that has come to our hearts today. Thank you for your precious love to those who know you, to those who have your righteousness, to those who are the possessors of your power, to those who fellowship with you in the deep things of life, and who will one day be glorified with you on your very throne. We thank you, Lord, for saving us. We thank you for the day when we came to know you and the power of your resurrection. We pray that this might be the day for those who have never come to know Christ, for those who are still trusting in their profit column, their assets, their human achievements, their morality, their religion. Oh God, may they see it for what it is: liability, dangerous, damning deception. And I pray that they may give themselves to Jesus Christ, who is to us knowledge, righteousness, power, and glory. We pray in his glorious holy name. Amen. Amen. Are you blessed today?